our faculty dean, Dr. Bagal sir, for giving me this opportunity, and also our principal ma'am, Dr. Anupama Patrikar, and the entire MUHS team for the wonderful opportunity. Today I will be discussing regulation of respiration. The normal respiratory rate in adults ranges between 12 to 18 per minute. This rate is basically adjusted according to the requirement of the body. Also, if you will see in the table down below, the rate for infants, toddlers, and children is relatively much higher than the rate for adults. The fact remaining that the respiratory tract is comparatively smaller, the respiratory muscles haven't developed well, so that results in lesser tidal volume or lower tidal volume, and so to compensate for that, you have a higher rate in the children. The normal respiratory rate in the adults is reached by the pubertal value. And the rate and depth of respiration, as we said, is adjusted according to the requirement of the body. So according to the metabolic rate of the body, if you are exercising, your metabolic rate goes higher, and so the rate and depth of respiration is increased. If you are resting or sleeping, your metabolic rate is lower. So what happens is your requirement for oxygen is less, carbon dioxide production is less, so the rate and depth of respiration will be decreased at that time. So we understand that there is some mechanism which is actually operating to regulate this respiration according to the body needs. This regulation is basically controlled by the respiratory center in the brain stem. The respiratory center, as we said, is the main center regulating respiration. This is present in the reticular formation of the pons and medulla, and it consists of three main areas, as you will see in the diagram down: the pneumotaxic area, the apneustic area, the medullary rhythmicity area. I repeat, the pneumotaxic area, the apneustic area, and the medullary rhythmicity area. The pneumotaxic area, as you will see in the diagram, is present in the upper part of the pons, and it controls the activity of the lower two centers. The apneustic area is present in the lower pons and is responsible for the apneustic type of respiration, that is characterized by inspiratory cramps. This is a type of respiration where inspiration is not cut off at the right time and the chest wall is held up in the inspiratory position for a longer than required position, resulting in exhaustion of the respiratory muscles. Then we have the medullary rhythmicity area, present in the medulla as the name suggests, and it is present in the lower part of the floor of the fourth ventricle. It includes the inspiratory center and the expiratory center. This center is basically responsible for gasping type of respiration. Gasping respiration is something, if you want to have an example, it is when, say, a person, if you see drowning, and when he's making a last attempt to come up to the surface, and when he's trying to breathe, he tries to breathe with his mouth wide open and taking in as much air as he can. This would be gasping type of respiration. Now back to the inspiratory and the expiratory center. The inspiratory center, you have an inspiratory center on either side of the midline of the medulla and an expiratory center on either side of the midline of medulla. Inspiratory center on both the sides are connected to each other. So stimulation of the inspiratory center on one side will lead to stimulation of the inspiratory center on the other side. So that's why when you inspire with both your lungs at the same time. Now you have the expiratory center on either side, and they are similarly connected to each other. So stimulation of one will result in stimulation of the other on the other side. That is why you expire at the same time on both the sides. I mean both the lungs at the same time. And the inspiratory center and expiratory center of the same side, the homolateral side, you have a to and fro connection between them. That means they can either way send signals to each other, and they reciprocally inhibit each other, so that when inspiration is in progress, expiration would not be allowed to start, or when expiration is in progress, inspiration would not begin. Moving on next to the respiratory center in details itself, we have this diagram which is showing you the pneumotaxic area and the apneustic area in the pons, and the medullary rhythmicity area comprising of inspiratory area and expiratory area in the medulla. Now the first dotted line, if you see, that means if there is damage or a section above the level of the medulla, then of course the pons, which includes the pneumotaxic area and apneustic area, will get cut off from the spinal cord, so that the connections would not be maintained. But yet you have the medullary rhythmicity area being connected to the spinal cord, so you have a fairly normal respiration being maintained despite this section. But if you have a section at the lower dotted line, that means below the medulla, then what happens is the entire respiratory centers are cut off from the spinal cord, and you do not have, the respiratory center has no connections with the spinal cord, and that is the area which is going to convey the messages to the lungs via the motor nerves, that would be your phrenic and intercostal nerves, for inspiration and expiration to progress. So you realize that medulla is a major rhythm generator. It has its own rhythmicity, and therefore it's known as medullary rhythmicity area. Next, we move on to factors controlling respiration. You have two sets of factors, important two sets of factors. Number one is the nervous factors, and number two are the chemical factors. The first nervous factors are the Herring-Brewer reflexes, in which you have an inflation reflex and a deflation reflex. The second nervous factor is impulses from ascending tracts of the spinal cord. And your third nervous factor is reflexes from the sinoaortic zone. If you see in the flowchart just by the side, you have nervous regulation or comprising of respiratory center being the main important coordinating area, which is in the pons and medulla, and of course the cerebral cortex has a control over these areas. Next, you have the chemical factors. The chemical factors, three important chemical factors: the partial pressure of carbon dioxide of arterial blood, H ion concentration of blood, I mean pH of the blood, and the partial pressure of oxygen of the arterial blood. So you have three nervous factors and three chemical factors controlling respiration. Just by the side of the chemical factors, you will see three areas that have been mentioned as sensors, central controller, and effectors. The sensors include your chemoreceptors, your pulmonary receptors, and some other receptors which pick up the sensory information from the periphery, the lungs, from the blood, and they give this sensory information, pass on the sensory information to the brainstem respiratory centers, which would be your central controller. and this central controller areas would send motor impulses to the effectors. They are your respiratory muscles, your diaphragm, and the abdominal muscles, along with the accessory muscles, and the, of course, the intercostal muscles. We go into the details of the nervous control of respiration. The first point in that are the Herring-Brewer reflexes. These reflexes are important because they help you to maintain the lung inflation in such a way that it is in coordination to the needs of the body, and cutting off inspiration at the right time and allowing expiration to begin at the right time, expiration being cut off at the right time and inspiration beginning at the right time. So you have two reflexes out here. You have the Herring-Brewer inflation reflex, which prevents over-distension of the lungs during inspiration. So it cuts off the inspiration at the right time so that unnecessarily the respiratory muscles would not be exhausted. The receptors for this reflex are the stretch receptors, which are sensitive to the effect of being stretched, and they are located in the bronchi and the bronchioles. The stretch receptors get stimulated when the lung inflates, and this inflation results in the stretching of these receptors, and afferent impulses from these stretch receptors travel in the vagi nerves, reach the respiratory center, and exert an inspiratory inhibiting effect. The Herring-Brewer deflation reflex prevents collapse of the lungs during expiration so that inspiration begins at the right time. The receptors being the compression receptors, which are located in the alveolar septae. The afferent impulses travel in the vagi. These compression receptors would get stimulated when the lung is compressed, is deflating, and because of that, the pulmonary pressure rises. The rise in pressure compresses these receptors get stimulated, the afferent impulses travel in the vagi nerves, reach the respiratory center, and exert an expiratory inhibiting effect. The physiological effect of Herring-Brewer reflexes is to maintain the lung inflation such that the tidal volume falls within useful range along with adjustment of the respiratory rate. The second important factor in the nervous regulation of respiration is impulses from ascending tracts of the spinal cord. Ascending tracts are the sensory tracts. The respiratory center basically receives impulses from collaterals of the ascending tracts of the spinal cord. And while these sensory impulses are reaching up via these tracts to the cerebral cortex, a few of them also go up to the cerebral, the respiratory center, and these sensory impulses play an important facilitatory role in maintaining normal respiration. These sensory impulses, which influence respiration in a great manner, are pain, moderately painful stimulus will stimulate the respiratory center, and this is applied when, say, a newborn baby doesn't cry immediately, doesn't breathe immediately, then it is slapped on its back, and that helps to, this moderate painful stimulus helps to stimulate the respiratory center, and that causes the first breath or the cry of the baby, and the baby starts breathing. Also, thermal senses, both heat and cold, stimulate respiration. We all have experienced the fact that when you splash cold water on your face, your respiratory pattern gets altered for that time. And when you exercise and heat is generated in your body, then your respiratory pattern is again altered, meaning rate and depth getting are increased. Also, impulses from muscular proprioceptors influence respiration. The muscular proprioceptors are sensors basically, which are present in all the muscles. So of course your respiratory muscles also, and these on being stimulated are going to regulate or influence the respiratory center. The main function actually of muscular proprioceptors is to keep the brain informed about the body image, about contraction, relaxation of the muscles. At the same time, it is sending impulses to the respiratory center and influencing respiration. Other senses which influence respiration are emotions, deglutition, hiccough, coughing, and sneezing. All of these are known to influence respiration. The third important factor in regulation of respiration are reflexes from the synovial zone. Synovial zone is the area which comprises of your carotid sinus and aortic arch, which are your baroreceptors, and your chemoreceptors being the carotid and aortic bodies. So there are two types of reflexes from the synovial zone. Whenever there is a sudden rise of pressure in this area, there is reflex slowing in the rate and depth of respiration. When there is slowing in the rate and depth of respiration, this results in decrease in the venous return. So a fall in your cardiac output, and this fall in cardiac output will help to check the sudden pressure rise that has occurred. The second condition is where you have a fall in blood pressure in this area. So that stimulates respiration reflexly through the chemoreceptors of this area. And when reflexly the respiration is stimulated, that helps to increase the venous return. Venous return increase, that increases your cardiac output, and thus the fall in pressure that has occurred is corrected. So these are the two reflexes from the synovial zone which help to influence respiration. So these were the three factors about for nervous regulation of respiration. You move on next to the chemical control of respiration. Chemical control of respiration, as we have said, includes three factors. Number one is the PCO2 of arterial blood, the PO2 of arterial blood, and the H ion concentration of blood. Now, the PCO2 of arterial blood and H ion concentration of blood, we will be considering together, because whenever there is a rise in carbon dioxide, in the body, that will result in carbon dioxide combining with water and resulting in formation of H2CO3, which will form, or in fact dissociate to give you H ions and HCO3 negative ions. Now, so we are therefore considering these two factors together along with each other. Oxygen pressure, partial pressure of oxygen, we would be considering later. Now, increased alveolar PCO2 stimulates respiration, which drives out more carbon dioxide from the lungs with each expiration, and this helps to keep the alveolar carbon dioxide in control. This compensation, of course, fails when carbon dioxide is in the inspired air exceeds more than 5%. Normally, the air that we inspire is the atmospheric air, and it has 0.3% percent, 0.03% of carbon dioxide in it. This carbon dioxide content, if it is increased up to 1% in the inspired air, till that point there is absolutely no change in respiration. But when this carbon dioxide in the inspired air comes up to around 4%, then the respiratory minute volume is increased. And beyond this point, there is, beyond this point, I mean beyond 5%, going up to 6%, etc., carbon dioxide in the inspired air in this large proportions will depress respiration. So there is a moderate, if the carbon dioxide rise is in moderate amounts, it will stimulate respiration. But in very large amounts, it will finally, the compensation will fail and carbon dioxide will have a depressing effect. As regards the site of action of carbon dioxide, are the chemoreceptors, which are receptors which are sensitive to the chemical changes in blood, being changes in carbon dioxide content, changes in oxygen content, and changes in the H ion contents of blood, pH, that is the pH of blood. So in regards to respiration, the chemoreceptors we concentrate on are the chemoreceptors present centrally in the medulla and peripherally in the carotid sinus and the aortic bodies. The main role or the main regulation is by the chemoreceptors present centrally. So 80% of the respiratory drive in the resting stage is because of the central chemoreceptors, and the remaining 20% is due to the peripheral chemoreceptors. The peripheral chemoreceptors are having a supportive role to the central chemoreceptors. These chemoreceptors, as we have said, are sensitive to carbon dioxide and H ion changes, and a rise in the partial pressure of carbon dioxide or a fall in the pH of blood will stimulate these chemoreceptors, which in turn stimulate the respiratory center, causing an increase in the volume and the frequency of respiration. Mode of action of carbon dioxide. A rise in carbon dioxide of blood results in a rise in carbon dioxide in the CSF and the tissue fluid in the brain, because carbon dioxide has a free access through the blood-brain barrier, so it can easily move on to the CSF and the tissue fluid. But H ions cannot actually cross over to the brain because of the blood-brain barrier. So the liberated H ions, or in fact, if there is a rise in the H ions at the level of the blood, that will not actually help in stimulating respiration. So a rise in carbon dioxide in the blood is more effective. So carbon dioxide, the reaction that you are seeing on your screen, carbon dioxide and water gives you H2CO3, gives you, or dissociates to give you H ions and HCO3, negative ions, and these H ions that are liberated help to stimulate the respiratory center directly. I repeat again, it has to be carbon dioxide diffusing to the brain and the CSF and then dissociating to H ion that will have a stimulating effect on the respiratory center. So we have considered two points in the chemical control of respiration. They were PCO2 of arterial blood and the H ion concentration. We move on next to the PO2 of arterial blood, the partial pressure of oxygen of arterial blood. A fall in the arterial PO2 results in stimulation of respiration. Normal atmospheric air contains 20.9% of oxygen. Now, if this oxygen content is decreased up to say 10%, then it is that your respiration gets stimulated, and this condition is similar to an altitude, a person residing or present at an altitude of 18,000 feet above sea level, where the oxygen content in the inspired air is such that the PO2 is only 10.5%. So respiration gets stimulated over there. And the respiration stimulating effect of oxygen lack is enhanced if you prevent the fall of alveolar PCO2. Now, this alveolar partial pressure of the alveolar carbon dioxide will be prevented if you add proper amounts of carbon dioxide to the inspired air. Mode of action of oxygen lack. This has to be via the sinoaortic nerves. So through the sinoaortic receptors, if this is detected, the oxygen lack, then it has a stimulating effect on respiration reflexly. But if the oxygen lack is directly actually in the brain tissue, then it will have a depressing effect on the respiratory center. Maximum stimulation of respiration is seen at arterial partial pressure of oxygen ranging between 60 to 30 millimeters of mercury. So if we are to summarize the chemical control of respiration, we see that pulmonary ventilation is increased whenever or increased by these three factors. Number one, rise in the arterial PCO2, a fall in the arterial PO2, and an increase in the arterial H ion concentration, that is, in other terms, a fall in the pH of blood. All these three factors are basically additive to one another, but any one of them can play a major role in driving respiration. So, say like if we take an example of metabolic acidosis, where the PO2, PCO2 are perfectly normal, but the H ion concentrations are increased. So that causes an increase in the rate of respiration and the respiration pattern gets disturbed. So down below we see there is a flow chart, and there we see that if there is a fall in oxygen or a rise in carbon dioxide or a fall in the pH of blood, this is detected by the chemoreceptors in the medulla, in the carotid and the aortic bodies, resulting in stimulation of the inspiratory center in the medulla, causing a rise in rate and depth of respiration so that more oxygen is made available to the blood and more carbon dioxide will be exhaled out during inspiration and expiration respectively. So to sum it all up, we have regulation of respiration you have to discuss in these two areas, nervous control and chemical control. In nervous control, as the name suggests, it would be all related to the brain and the nerves and the related things. So you have the important regulatory area being the respiratory center, which is comprising of three areas: pneumotaxic area, apneustic area, and the medullary rhythmicity area, comprising of the inspiratory and the expiratory center. And the important regulating factors in the nervous mechanism are the Herring-Brewer reflexes, comprising of inflation reflex and a deflation reflex, the impulses from ascending tracts of the spinal cord, and lastly, reflexes from the sinoaortic zone. So these are your three important regulating factors in the nervous control of respiration. On the other side, you have the chemical control, which is actually the detection is done by the chemoreceptors being present centrally in the medulla and peripherally in the carotid body and the aortic bodies. And the regulating factors out here are also three important factors. You have the PCO2 of arterial blood, the H ion concentration of blood, or in other terms, the pH of the blood, and third, the PO2 of arterial blood. So you have three factors on either side in the nervous control as well as the chemical control. These are the points that you need to cover while writing your answer in your examination paper. This question of regulation of respiration is very frequently asked, and frequently asked for 20 marks. So if you include all these points along with a good label diagram of the respiratory center, and you can add up if you want a few other diagrams, then you get a good, answer for 20 marks. But you have to include all of these points. But sometimes you also have a 10 marks question on this topic, which is asked as either only on nervous control or either only on chemical control. Both of them would not be asked, because then it becomes a 20 marks answer. So that's about how to attempt the answer. And just a short mention of the hormones that influence respiration. Important ones are first progesterone, which is a predominantly female hormone, which stimulates ventilation. And progesterone is increased during pregnancy and the secretory phase of the menstrual cycle. So definitely ventilation would be increased during these stages. The other hormones that influence respiration are thyroxine, cortisol, and catecholamines. Thyroxine being a thyroid hormone, cortisol and catecholamines being secreted by the adrenal gland, the cortex, and the medulla respectively. So that's all from my side. Thank you so much.